January 19th, 2004 was obviously a bad day in our family. I was at work that day. It was a Monday, Martin Luther King Day. I got a call from a very panicked neighbor, and she told me that my wife, Judy, and our son Joe, 12-year-old son Joe, had been in a crash. It wasn't very far from where I worked. It wasn't very far from our home. So I got in the car and went over there, and it was obviously a bad situation. Judy was in an ambulance, and I went up to her and I talked to her first, and she was shook up but okay, but she said, please check on Joe. And I went back to the car, and he was trapped in the car, and the paramedics and firefighters were trying to get him out, and he wasn't breathing. They had no blood pressure, and it was obviously a very, very bad situation. I rode with him in the ambulance to the hospital. He was on life support for probably about 12 hours. He never regained consciousness, and at about 4 in the morning, he died. And we found out later that a young lady was talking on a cell phone, looking straight out the window, ran a red light in broad daylight, didn't hit the first car that was passing in front of her. Judy was the third or fourth car, and caused the crash while talking on a cell phone. You lose a child and it changes your life forever. It's been 6 years now as we do this interview, and it's still painful every single day. I think of Joe every single day. I miss him terribly. And the hardest thing to reconcile is that, you know, he died because of a phone call. There was no other reason. This driver was looking straight out the window. Our family's never been the same. I have two other sons. Judy and I have two other sons, and they're doing okay, but they still struggle with lost Joe. We had a one of those wonderful, perfect family lives. I remember Joe used to say, every day I said to Joe that I loved him, and Judy did too, and he started saying back to us, well, I love you more. And he'd say, no, we love you more. And I remember probably just a few weeks before he died that he came up to me when I came home from work, and he ran up and he hugged me and he said, hi, Daddy-O. And I said, how you doing, Joe? And he said, I'm great. And he said, I love you, Dad. And this was just in the afternoon or late afternoon. And I remember walking back to the closet to hang up my coat and kind of looking up and just thanking God for what a wonderful relationship with Joe. And 2 weeks later, he was gone. Someone described it to me early on. I'll never forget this. They said, you know, when you lose a child, you never, ever get over it. It's not something you live through or work through, but you do learn how to live a little better with it as time goes on. And I think that's the case here. But the hardest thing is you just miss your son. You know, you miss talking to him. You miss the hugs. And that will never change. That will never change. Judy and I have met a lot of people in this journey over the past several years who are in the same position as us, many who have lost children. And it's just hard to know what to say. We've learned that roughly 100 people die every single day in the United States from crashes, auto crashes. About 90% of those are caused by driver error. Most of those are the result of driver distraction. And cell phones are the number one distraction. You know, this is a threat that didn't exist just a few years ago. We need a combination of laws, public safety laws that say it's not okay to risk other people's lives. They're really no different than drunk driving laws. We need laws. We need them enforced. We need people to become educated about this. And we need technology and engineering solutions, and I think a lot of companies are working on that. We hear a lot that all distractions are dangerous and we shouldn't pick on cell phones, for example, and I can understand why people would say that, but there's actually some pretty significant differences. And there's two things that result in crashes. One is the danger of the risk itself, the activity we're involved in. And cell phone use while driving has about a 4x odds ratio of crashing. In other words, you're 4x more likely to crash if you're using a cell phone than if you're not using one. There's no difference between handheld and hands-free. That's a pretty significant distraction. There are other distractions that are worse. Reaching for a moving object is about 9x more likely to crash. But the difference is, the other half of the equation is how often are people doing it. You know, we know people put on makeup while driving. Thank goodness not that many people do it at any given time. But cell phones, we think about 10% of all drivers at any given time are talking on a cell phone while driving. That's off the charts compared to other distractions. Plus, cell phone use is something definitive. There's something we can do about cell phone use. We can take cell phones, we can help people not use cell phones while driving. We can put technology on cell phones that will make them safer. So there are things we can do about that. We're probably not going to be able to do much about some of the other kinds of human behavior that causes distraction. Key thing is our exposure to the risks, the prevalence of the use, and the degree of distraction. Cell phones are off the charts when it comes to that. I've been working on the issue of distracted driving now for probably about 5 years. And about 2 or 3 years ago, I got involved with a lot of the wireless carriers and the wireless industry. And you know, there's no bad guy in this issue. This multi-billion dollar industry grew out of what we call car phones. And we never understood the cognitive impact of talking on a phone. We never had to. We were always sitting in an easy chair joined to a wire to the phone. So we're just starting to understand this. I think the wireless industry has really come on board with trying to get behind this and keep people from getting hurt. They've come out very clearly on texting. They do not want people to text while drive. They're no longer opposing any opposition to any other kind of cell phone regulation. And I think they've become good partners with us. So I'm very, very pleased with what the wireless industry is doing. And actually, you know, I've challenged a lot of the wireless carriers, and most of them are stepping up to this. But, you know, they have the ability, through installing technology on the network that is capable of determining when a phone is in a car and when it's driving, they have the ability to actually give us an engineering solution to this. And I think you're going to see a few of those introduce those kind of solutions in the very next few months.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great coverage of all major motor events, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive resource.